Inside the Magic, show number 376 for June 18th, 2012.
Hey, everybody! Welcome to the cutest little town in Carburetor County.
Some folks say the highway's fine if you want to get from place to place. Man, don't you know you ought to take your time, you ought to take it at a different pace. If you want to drop into a spot that swang, take it down to Radiator Springs.
It is Monday, June 18th, 2012. This is show 376 of Inside the Magic. And as always, I am your host, Ricky Briganti. We have a great show packed with the usual assortment of Disney and theme park news. And then we will be diving deep into the new Cars Land over at Disney California Adventure. So much fun to talk about there. And before we get to all of that, I do invite you to visit our website over at InsideTheMagic.net. There you'll find all of our podcasts, videos, photos, news, articles, and so much more. And if you ever have any news, tips, questions, comments, or anything else you want to say to me, you can write to me via email at ricky@insidethemagic.net, or you can call and leave a message at 407-494-4ITM. That's 4486. And now, let's get on with the show.
Welcome.
This week's episode of Inside the Magic is brought to you by Magical Travel. Adventures by Disney vacations are amazing, carefree family experiences with memories that will last a lifetime, and 2013 itineraries are now available. Lay away your vacation today and receive up to a $500 Visa gift card when you book an Adventures by Disney destination vacation with Magical Travel by calling 866-207-8387 or visit them online at magicaltravel.com to receive a free price quote. And be sure to mention Inside the Magic when you do that to receive a free Disney gift card for qualifying bookings when you book your Disney vacation with Magical Travel. And by listeners and viewers like you, thanks very much for your contributions to the show, be it a one-time donation, recurring monthly donation, or just clicking through those affiliate links over at InsideTheMagic.net. It all goes back to support the show. Thank you very much for that. And now, let's get started with our trip around the world. So obviously we're going to be talking a lot about the Disney California Adventure, specifically Cars Land this week. Just a few days ago, I got back yesterday, and that's why this is a Monday edition of Inside the Magic. I got back from several days out in California and was there for the massive press event that was for the reopening / rededication of Disney California Adventure, culminating the five-year, $1 billion plus improvement project, if you will, for that park, really bringing that park to be a worthy second park for the Disneyland Resort. Of course, the culmination of it all was Cars Land, which opened officially just a few days ago, along with the new entrance area, Buena Vista Street. All the walls came down, lots of crowds showed up, and we'll be talking about the shows and the characters and the ride and the performances and the special events and so much more. In fact, there has been so much that I'm not going to be able to pack it all into this week's show. I'm going to, talk about it over the next few weeks, and Cars Land will be the primary focus here this week. I do want to say thank you to everybody who followed along for the roughly 4 days worth of live blogging and Twitter and Facebook, and unfortunately I was too busy for a meetup out in California this time around. It was such a busy few days. It was almost a nonstop. I got very, very little sleep just from running around, and it was at Cars Land for red carpet opening and interviews and a opening party Wednesday night, and the next day was even more. I think I interviewed like 10 to 15 people on Thursday, and some other few special happenings, and I thought I was going to spend that day shooting video and photos and experiencing Cars Land and Buena Vista Street, but it turns out that because of all the media that was there, Disney had set up all these risers and cameras and lighting rigs and radio station booths and all this stuff in the streets, so I didn't actually have a chance to then shoot everything that I wanted to until the following 2 days on Friday and Saturday. And so anyway, it was just a really, really hectic few days. So, you know, I'm happy to do it. Obviously, it was a lot of fun. And I can't wait to bring it all to you. Some of it has already been posted on our YouTube channel and over at InsideTheMagic.net. And there's much, much more in the coming weeks for Cars Land, Buena Vista Street, and all of that. So before we get to my thoughts on Cars Land this week, let's talk about the other news of the week, and then we'll dive into that subject. But we are going to start actually with Disney California Adventure with something that was a bit of a surprise amidst all of the planned excitement that was part of this big press event. There was one surprise that Disney had for the media, which was a pretty cool one. After, I think it was Thursday night, after the Buena Vista Street / Mad Tea Party nighttime event, all the attending media and friends and family and invited guests were asked to go watch World of Color, see the new Brave sequence, which I'll talk about here in a minute. But what surprised everybody was what Disney decided to hand out to everybody that was there, and I've got mine right here. It is the what they're calling the Glow with the Show Mickey Mouse ears. And for those of you watching the video version of the show, I'm actually going to turn off the lights here so you can see it glow here in the old Inside the Magic studio. Now, these lights are, this Mickey ear hat does light up. Both of the ears light up in a rainbow of colors. And the idea is not only just to, I'll turn it off so I don't waste the battery on them. The idea is not only just to light up and look cool. I mean, Disney certainly has plenty of light up things you can wear on your head around the parks. But these are actually interactive with Disney's shows, hence Glow with the Show. And Disney, of course, handed them out to all the media, as I said. Hundreds of people all gathered together in front of World of Color to watch it together, and it was quite the sight. I've posted video already over on the website and on our YouTube channel, but essentially, to describe it, basically, if a scene came up, like, let's say, the Little Mermaid scene, all of a sudden, all of the ears across the entire crowd turned blue. Or the Wall-E scene turned on, and all of them, one ear turned off, and the other ear was white, so it looked like a star field across the crowd, and it was really in sync with the music and the fountains and the projections and everything else that's part of World of Color. Really, really impressive to see it not only have all of them change colors, but also in different sections, or they'll sparkle all the way across. Not every ear did exactly the same thing, and it was you know, in sections front to back and left to right, and really became part of the show. I'm not entirely sure how exactly that's achieved. It's a bit of Disney magic. I'm guessing it's some sort of RFID technology with some, you know, proximity sensors around different areas, and the hats actually work in Mad Tea Party and in Cars Land, and it seems like there's going to be more areas of the Disneyland Resort where they will interact as well. There's certainly tremendous possibilities for the future of this, as long as large amounts of people are in the audience wearing these new Mickey ears that light up. But if only a couple of people wear them, it's not so great. I went back to see World of Color the following night. So it went from one night that was media-only World of Color showing everybody wearing them. And the next night, they were for sale. They're $25, including tax, and available now at Disney California Adventure and a number of stores across the park. And only a handful of people were wearing them the next night. Mostly it was cast members that were working there trying to get people to buy them. So it was not too impressive when only like three people are wearing them. But as more and more annual pass holders purchase them and start to bring them and wear them to the parks regularly, I think it could prove to be something pretty cool. My only sort of complaint with them is that if I were seeing World of Color for the very first time and somebody was standing right in front of me with glowing Mickey ears, it would probably drive me nuts because I would want to watch the show, not the person's head in front of me. But for locals, and this is really what it's intended for people who have seen World of Color, you know, countless times already, this really works even beyond that, and it does apply and work to other parts of the park as well, which is pretty cool. So definitely check out the video over at InsideTheMagic.net to see it working in World of Color, as well as another video in Mad Tea Party. Pretty cool technology. So, as I said, World of Color was also updated once again with a new sequence, this time in honor of Disney Pixar's Brave, which comes out this Friday, although I'll be seeing it tomorrow night in a screening. We'll definitely post a review of it this week and probably talk about it on next week's show as well. But Brave, the latest Pixar film, is now featured in World of Color. A little spoilery, actually. Surprisingly, there's minor spoilers in the World of Color sequence. Some great bagpipe music, sort of driving music. fantastic, and I think the sequence will be even better after everybody's had a chance to actually see the movie when it comes out in just a few days. Also debuting just a few days ago at Disney California Adventure, as if Cars Land and Buena Vista wasn't enough, they've added all these other things to the park as well, all in the same time. There's a new daytime show called Instant Concert, Just Add Water, and it stars Maestro Goofy conducting the World of Color fountains around Paradise Pier, but during the day, so it's nice to see those fountains being used during the day. Goofy comes out in his conductor outfit with his baton, and it plays out like a Goofy short. It's actually pretty funny. It's very short. It's only about 3 or 4 minutes long. You walk up, you enjoy it, you have a few laughs, and then it's over and done with. So if you want to see a video of the debut of that show as well, head on over to InsideTheMagic.net. Turning over to Disneyland Park, the Matterhorn bobsleds finally, after about 6 months, reopened just a few days ago, and I had a chance to ride that as well. The Yetis throughout, I rode both sides of the mountain, and the Yetis look fantastic. They're scarier than ever. They look roughly the same, but the lighting has been enhanced, and the sounds and the volume has been enhanced. There are mountain climbers periodically climbing up and down the mountain once again, which is a great, fun little show that happens. There's now single rider line on the Matterhorn, which is great. It's a little confusing because they didn't have, I don't think, proper signage, perhaps just not up yet when I was there, but having single rider line is definitely a great thing. However, the new bobsled vehicles, the actual ride vehicles that you sit in, I am not at all a fan of. Of course, the old Matterhorn bobsled vehicles, you would sit in somebody's lap or somebody would sit in your lap and you would kind of strap together and go on your ride together. Well, the new ones have individual seats and individual seat belts, and they're really small and cramped. I'm surprised. They're not comfortable in the slightest. They didn't really smooth out the ride. It's still bumpy. They still throw you around. And there's three seats per section of the whole car. It's, you know, six people length of the train, and then three and three is basically what I'm trying to say. Very much like a Space Mountain is out here in Florida. They look a lot like the Space Mountain vehicles, but they are smaller. Especially if you sit in the front of either a section, you have to kind of have your knees upward, like up almost to your chest, and there's really nowhere to put your feet. And then if you're in the back ones, you kind of have to stick your feet in these little holes and they get stuck, and it's really hard to get out afterwards. I am just simply not a fan of these new Matterhorn cars. I rode the one side and the other literally back to back because of something weird that happened with the line where we were actually trying to exit and they just directed us right back on the ride, which I wasn't going to complain, but it was a little odd. But anyway, so I rode it back to back and I was not thrilled the second time around because I had already been bumped around the first time, and it was even less comfortable the second time. So good looking mountain, good paint job, great Yetis, fun entertainment. The new cars, not so much. I did record, of course, my ride on both sides, and I'll be posting video of that pretty soon. So while I was in California for a few days, news did not stop out here in Orlando, and I actually have not had a chance to check out these items in person yet. I plan to within the next few days. Over at the Magic Kingdom, pretty much the rest of Storybook Circus, almost the rest of Storybook Circus, has opened up, at least a good chunk of it. The second carousel on Dumbo has opened up, as well as the Casey Jr. Splash and Soak play area. We still haven't seen any sign of the sort of other tents of Storybook Circus, so it's not all open yet, but at least the part that was, you know, on the right side, the Dumbo area, and then sort of a little bit more in the middle have opened up as well. So you know, I'm sure I'm not going to spend a lot of time in the Casey Jr. Soak and Splash or Splash and Soak area, or the Dumbo Big Top for that matter, or even riding Dumbo. It's never been a favorite attraction of mine, but for those who are bringing kids or who are fans of that attraction, it certainly is looking better than ever. Also, while I was out in California over at Disney's Art of Animation Resort, our own version of Cars has now opened up here in Orlando. It's not Cars Land, but it is the Cars Wing of Disney's Art of Animation Animation Resort. It has a Cozy Cone Motel and Mater and all kinds of characters around, Lightning McQueen, etc., etc. I'll definitely head over there to check that out and bring back some photos and video and all that good stuff pretty soon. In addition, over at Epcot, Agent P's World Showcase Adventure began testing this weekend. It's supposed to debut within the next few days officially, and early reports say that Agent P's adventure is very, very similar to Kim Possible's adventure, though that's pretty much what we were expecting. There may be a few tweaks in the effects here and there, but really it's just taking the Kim Possible characters out and putting in the Phineas and Ferb characters instead. So not a huge, huge difference in that experience. Now, just before I left on my own little California adventure, the night before, I went over to Universal Orlando because I wanted to see the new Despicable Me Minion Mayhem attraction, which is currently in technical rehearsal. The opening date was announced actually literally as I was on an airplane to California. They announced it as July 2nd, so still a couple of weeks away for them to continue testing and really getting the attraction to where it needs to be. But it was, for the most part, complete when I was going through, and it's a fun and entertaining ride. It's the latest in a series of motion simulator rides in this sort of front of the park location at Universal Studios Florida. Of course, previously Jimmy Neutron's Nicktoon Blast and the Hanna-Barbera ride, which I really missed, were in this location, and now it is Despicable Me Minions Mayhem. You enter the attraction through the new facade that is Gru's house from the film Despicable Me, and you kind of wind your way through his living areas, outdoors and indoors, and ultimately find your way into his lab, where there's a great, funny pre-show video, and then you go into the actual theater, where you have a 3D, really big 3D motion simulator experience that I think was better than Jimmy Neutron, but still not as good as the old Hanna-Barbera, but I'm sure that's just nostalgia talking. After the attraction itself, you end up in a big round room with Boogie Fever playing, and the Minions are up on the screen, then you're supposed to sort of dance along, and some fun little effects happen in there as well. I enjoyed it. You know, I've actually not seen Despicable Me yet, and I kind of did that on purpose. I wanted to see if this attraction appealed to me at all without having seen the movie, and it did. I understood the characters. The cue videos are great. They're funny, and they really introduced the characters well. Now I'm going to go see the movie, and then I'll probably appreciate it even more. So, it's a fun ride. It's not a mind-blowing e-ticket or anything, but it is enjoyable. And then also, in one quick other bit of Universal Orlando news, those of you like me who are big fans of Halloween Horror Nights will be interested to know that tickets are now on sale for this year's Halloween event. So now let's move to the world of movies, where Disney has announced that the highly acclaimed and highly anticipated computer-generated slash hand-drawn animated short called Paper Man is going to make its theatrical debut in front of Wreck-It Ralph when that hits theaters on November 2nd of this year. It's a black and white style that follows the story of a lonely young man, as it's described, in mid-century New York, whose destiny takes an unexpected turn after a chance meeting with a beautiful woman on his morning commute. And it goes on from there. I don't need to read the entire description about what it's all about, but from what I've heard, this Paperman short is supposed to be absolutely amazing and a groundbreaking experience when it comes to the world of animation. I don't know any more about it because everybody's remaining quite tight-lipped, but I am looking forward to seeing it in November. Walt Disney Animation Studios this week also announced the next adventure comedy computer animated featured film called Frozen to come out in November 2013. Follows sort of in the same type of title as Tangled. Now it's Frozen, and it's going to star Kristen Bell as Anna, as the lead character, as well as actress Idina Menzel as Elsa, the Snow Queen, and it will feature original songs by Broadway greats Robert Lopez and Kristen Anderson Lopez. Frozen will feature prophecy traps a kingdom in eternal winter, so Anna must team up with Kristoff, a daring mountain man, on the grandest of journeys to find the Snow Queen and put an end to the icy spell. So that is your next big computer animated movie following Wreck-It Ralph from Walt Disney Animation Studios. That's coming out November of 2013. Also announced this week were some changes of dates. Planes, which is a sort of spin-off of Cars, is not going to theaters, but it's going to Blu-ray and DVD, and that's going to release in fall of 2013. It was going to be spring of 2013. And Disney Fairies Quest for the Queen is now going to be released in spring of 2014 and was fall of 2013, so that got pushed back, and that'll be on Blu-ray and DVD as well. And the Walt Disney Studios announced a really exciting exhibition that I am definitely looking forward to seeing in just a couple of weeks. It's a touring exhibition, The Art of Tim Burton's Frankenweenie. Of course, Frankenweenie is going to be hitting theaters on October 5th of this year, but the touring exhibition is going to bring around original sketches, props, entire sets, and puppets that are used in this stop-motion film. It's going to start in Barcelona, Spain at Cine Europe. Actually, it started yesterday, June 18th through the 21st. It will eventually make its way through Spain, France, England, Japan, Mexico, Canada, and to the United States, where it will show up at the San Diego Comic-Con next month, July 11th through 15th, and that is where I will be seeing it, because I will once again be returning to San Diego Comic-Con this year. I had so much fun doing it last year for the first time. I definitely could not resist going back again, especially because it seems like Disney is going to have a much bigger presence now that there's no D23 Expo this year, so I'm looking forward to seeing the Frankenweenie stuff and whatever else Disney unveils there at Comic-Con. And then in addition, September 14th through November 5th, the Frankenweenie traveling exhibition will be in Anaheim, California, presumably in the Disneyland area. And speaking of exhibits, D23 is still prepping their new exhibit for the Ronald Reagan Library and Museum in Simi Valley, California, that's opening up in just a couple of weeks. It's the Treasures of the Walt Disney Archives exhibit, and tickets are going on sale to that exhibit for advance purchase beginning June 26th, a little less than a week, actually. I guess 1 week. Yeah, roughly a week. Anyway, June 26th. So one more bit of news for this week. This is coming out of the world of television, though it crosses with your portable technology, where there are new apps from Disney Channel, Disney XD, and Disney Junior, in which if your TV provider offers the services as part of your video subscription, you can now get Disney channels live on your mobile device, as well as episodes on demand. It's for iPhone, iPad, and iPod Touch. It's for Disney Channel, Disney XD, and Disney Junior, but you're gonna have to make sure that it's part of your proper subscription package for cable and all of that. But you can go check out those apps in the iTunes store. And that is it for your news from around the world this week. And this week's tip actually comes in from me. After spending a whole lot of time within Cars Land and seeing the massive crowds that showed up for the grand opening, which we'll talk more about in just a minute, I have a couple of tips related to the biggest ride and the most highly anticipated in Cars Land. Of course, that's Radiator Springs Racers. The first tip is a little bit obvious. It's, of course, get there as early as you possibly can. Lines have been very, very long for Radiator Springs Racers, and Disney's actually been opening up the park entrance a bit before planned times. It's been opening up at 8 a.m., but they've actually let people in even before 8, and fast passes have been going extremely quickly for the entire day, and lines have been hours and hours long. So if you want to get on Radiator Springs Racers very quickly, show up well in advance of 8 a.m., grab that fast pass on the way over, and then maybe you'll at least get a couple of rides in. And also my personal tip, I kind of like the right front seat on this ride. It's for many reasons, one of my favorite spots. So there it is, my little tip for Cars Land. Everybody else out there, email your tips into tips@insidethemagic.net. And we are going to talk a lot about Cars Land here coming up in just a minute, but first let me put in a quick word about Lanyard Lab. Normally I put this a little bit later in the show, but I'm going to be talking extensively about Cars Land and didn't want to stick it right in the middle. So lanyardlab.com is the website where you can customize your own lanyards, whether you're going to use it for promotional, for a business or at a convention to hand out, or if you just need to wear it around your neck with an ID card or a name tag, perhaps at a school or a church. And again, lanyardlab.com is the place to do it. Just click on Get a Quote, fill out the form, submit it to us, and we'll email you back with a price quote along with a proof showing you what the lanyards will look like. It's all free to try, and you can submit any changes from there, or you can just order online. It's as easy as that. Once again, lanyardlab.com. That's LanyardLab.com. So it is time to talk about all that is Cars Land. So much excitement has been building up for this addition to Disney California Adventure for so many years now, and I'd like to preface it by simply saying I have never been a big fan of cars, and yet I really, really loved Cars Land. What an amazing addition to a Disney theme park, a really classic Disney Imagineering built area, just very impressive all the way through. Before I get too far into talking about the actual land itself and its attractions, I want to take a step back a little bit and take you kind of to the grand opening of Cars Land, which despite the fact that Cars Land opened to the public on June 15th to many, many people who showed up that morning, the quote-unquote official grand opening actually took place on the evening, on the night, actually right at sunset, of June 13th, two nights before. And that's because June 14th was an all-day media day at the park, and then the 15th is when they unveiled it to everybody. And the grand opening, there was a big stage set up right at the entrance to Radiator Springs, right across from the Blue Sky Cellar, where so many have been peering over the construction walls for years now, literally years now. And the stage was set up and ready to go for what was probably the longest grand opening anything that I've ever attended. It ended up being about 40 minutes long, so I'm not going to share the entire thing with you right now here. But what I do want to share with you is a bit of a clip of the beginning of it all, which started with a band, a live band, off to the side, and they were dressed as a sort of race crew costumes, and they were themed to the Rusty's brand, which of course was Lightning McQueen's sponsor in Cars. And I just want to play a song that they played right at the beginning of this the grand opening celebration, and then we can take it off from there and talk a bit more about what happened during the grand opening and of course to Cars Land itself. So here is the Rusty's band, as I like to call them.
It's going to begin in just a few minutes, but first let's rock this park. Even driving the tour.
There you have it, the Rusty's Band, or the Cars Land Band, or whatever you want to call them. That was them performing one of several songs at the beginning, just before the grand opening ceremony of Cars Land, which was quite the packed ceremony. Quite a lot of different things happened throughout. It began with Disney CEO and President Bob Iger saying a few words, who then brought onto the stage Tom Staggs, chairman of Walt Disney Parks and Resorts, who then in turn introduced a man that needs no introduction to anybody. Of course, that is John Lasseter, the creator of Cars, director of Cars, and many, many, many other roles at both Pixar and Disney and Walt Disney Imagineering and beyond. And certainly plenty of things to say. Was very excited, and I actually want to take you over there now to listen to a bit about what John Lasseter said, and you'll hear a little bit from Tom Staggs as well. And then there's a very funny bit that that John Lasseter did for everybody there at the opening that I definitely wanted to share. As I said, the opening was very, very long, and I am cutting parts out of it here, but this in my opinion, was the most entertaining part of it all. So let's hop back over to the grand opening of Cars Land to hear first from John Lasseter, then Tom Staggs, then Lasseter once again.
I want to start by saying thank you to Bob Iger, to Jay Rasulla, and to you, Tom, for this. You know, investing in the beauty of this Disney California Adventure without you guys, you know, the future guests coming to the land would not have this amazing place that we have now. Thank you, you guys. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Jay. You guys are the best. You know, working with the Walt Disney Imagineers and working so closely with them and all the cast members on Cars Land, you know, has been an absolute thrill for all of us at Pixar, but especially for me, because these characters and stories are so close to me personally, you know. Now, wow, I love all of my children, all of the films at Pixar equally. The Cars films are really particularly close to my heart because they combine two of my great passions in life, animation and Cars. When I was a kid growing up not far from here, just up the Santa Ana Freeway, go up the 605 a little, get off the Beverly Boulevard in Whittier, that's where I grew up, about half an hour from here. My mom was an art teacher at a high school for 38 years, and my dad was a parts manager at a Chevrolet dealership. So you can sort of say that basically, I guess I was destined from birth to create an animated film about Cars. Now, when we were developing Cars, I had the unique opportunity to take my beautiful wife, Nancy. Nancy's right down here somewhere. Yay, Nancy Lasseter! There she is right there. Sons on a road trip across Route 66 to experience life on the Mother Road. So many of the people and the places we encountered along the way served as the inspiration for Radiator Springs and its inhabitants. So, Tom, it's an amazing feeling to stand here right now and see the world that we created for this film actually come to life.
There's so many people that are excited, and I have to say, one of the things that I love most about Cars Land is how every element, big and small, works together to create this immersive world where our guests can enjoy themselves with their family and their friends. But from the attractions, the entertainment, the food, the merchandise, the costumes, even the plants and flowers, everything meshes together to transport our guests to the world of Cars, and thanks to all the efforts of the Imagineers, you, the folks at Pixar, this place really is real at this point.
It is so, Tom, you're so right. It is, you can't believe the immersive nature. And it goes back to the essence of Walt Disney created with Disneyland, that you know, where he takes you to another place in another time. Cars Land is so full of the amazing, tiny little details, and the harder you look, the more you will find. And that's, you know, that's what makes Disney, Disney. I can't wait for all our guests to see it. It's going to be fantastic.
John! Up here! Boy.
Yeah, hi. Oh, boy. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to John Lasseter, my alter ego from Cars 2. How's it going?
Hey, I got a great idea for a new Cars 2. It's about a pickup truck with wood paneling. Huh?
Oh,
wow, that sounds really great, John. Yeah, I'm going to have to think about it a little bit.
Oh, come on. Pickup trucks. Wood paneling is the next big thing, dude.
Okay. We'll definitely get together. I'm a little busy right now opening Cars Land, but I tell you what, call my office, okay?
Okay, call your office. Good. I'll get on your schedule. You know, I know it's going to be like next year sometime. But you're going to love it when you hear it. Enjoy the rest of the ceremony, dude. Bye, everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, John Lasseter.
So there you go. That was a little bit of John Lasseter and Tom Staggs and a bit from John Lasseter as well, which it was pretty amusing. They went on to also show what perhaps Tom Staggs and Bob Iger would look like as Cars characters, which was pretty funny. I will soon post the entire very long opening ceremony over on InsideTheMagic.net and our YouTube channel, so if you want to see the whole thing. But let's go back there one more time for the very end of it. What had happened actually was as the ceremony moved on, John Lasseter had quite a few special guests to bring up to the stage who had just previously walked the red carpet moments prior, and they were many of the voice actors who were part of the Cars universe, and those who were in attendance were definitely recognizable voices, or rather actors and actresses from Hollywood, including Bonnie Hunt was there, who voiced Sally, and Cheech Marin, who voiced Ramon, and of course John Ratzenberger, who voiced a character in every single Pixar film ever made, including Mac in the Cars series, which was great to see those celebrities there. And then in the end, they brought up the biggest star of the night, Mater himself, Larry the Cable Guy, came up on stage, and he had the distinct honor of sort of introducing the end of the whole ceremony, which is what I want to share with you now to wrap up this grand opening of Cars Land. So let's hop back on over to that stage in front of Radiator Springs at Disney California Adventure one more time for the conclusion of the grand opening of Cars Land.
Not the greatest thing ever, everybody. Is this not great? I mean, it's almost like we're stepping into Radiator Springs. It's unbelievable, but I gotta say this. It's not complete without two people that should be here. You cannot start any of this without Mater and Lightning McQueen.
And there you have it, the official opening of Cars Land, one of those fun confetti-filled and fireworks-backed moments at a Disney park that they love to do at those grand opening ceremonies. Immediately following that was my first impression of Cars Land. It was my first chance to walk inside at this nighttime party that lasted for a couple hours. But the first impression that most people got of Cars Land was a very, very different one on the Friday that followed, just a day and a half later. in the morning of June 15th. It was apparently at the time the biggest crowd that had been to Disney California Adventure, the first time that the park had ever topped Disneyland in attendance for the day. The crowd that showed up lined up beginning at 11 p.m. officially, 11 p.m. the night before, but even people showed up prior to that to line up, and they were there for many, many hours overnight waiting to get into the park, and clearly there was just a little bit of excitement involved there. The line for Radiator Springs Racers actually stretched for, well, very, very long throughout the park. There was a posted time of 240 minutes for Radiator Springs Racers, but that wasn't even accurate. It was more like a 5 to 6 hour wait. Single rider line was up to 120 minutes at 2 hours at one point. And the line not only wrapped around the very large Radiator Springs Racers queue, which is a long, winding queue, but the line continued all the way outside of the attraction, outside of Cars Land, actually started in Cars Land in the ride, went outside of Cars Land, moved out beyond the entirety of Radiator Springs and into the Pacific Wharf area of Disney California Adventure, and then into, you know, across the bridge and around the corner into the Paradise Pier Bridge. And then the really fun part was that that wasn't the end of the line. That was actually the middle of the line, because then it turned around and went all the way back to Cars Land and into Radiator Springs Racers. It was probably the longest line I've ever seen in a Disney park. The line was the couple of days later on the Sunday was very, very long as well. I saw it posted up to 300 minutes at one point. It just seemed to stretch on and on and on, and amazed me that anybody would want to wait that long for a ride, considering that, you know, a few days later, maybe a couple of weeks later, you'd be able to not have such a long line. But then there's that excitement of being there on opening day, and, you know, if you're going to be there, you might as well commit, stand in the extremely long line, and just go for it. And a lot of people did. Obviously, it was very, very long, an impressive sight to see. Of course, as I said, my first time, on the other hand, was a very different experience. And stepping into Cars Land for the first time, it was nighttime rather than daytime, and it was that evening when the party was going on inside the area, and I was simply blown away by the entire area. It was absolutely gorgeous at night. Obviously, Disneyland has been putting it into advertisements that saying that you're going to be floored, you know, a little car pun there, you're going to be floored when you go to Cars Land, and really that is a great word for it. I haven't walked into a totally immersive themed environment like that since stepping into the Wizarding World of Harry Potter for the very first time, although this has, I don't want to sit here and make comparisons, you know, back and forth between that, because they're really two entirely different things. All I'm saying is that Cars Land certainly has its own unique style, and it is pure Disney Imagineering, and I was just thrilled to be there at night for the first time, where it's just absolutely gorgeous to just walk around with all the neon around you in Radiator Springs. This area does not fall back on any of the sort of the crutches or the innovations that quote-unquote that Imagineers are using today, particularly in Orlando. There's no interactive queues, there's no screens, there's no virtual environments, just classic Imagineering at its finest and most impressive. And Cars Land is just filled with real life details. Pixar and John Lasseter's sort of virtual world of Cars from the film now exists in reality in Disney California Adventure. Now there really is a little town called Radiator Springs with residents to meet and food to enjoy and benches to kick back on and, of course, exciting races and rides. And in the past few days, I've had a chance to talk to many of the folks who were in charge in creating Cars Land, or charge of creating Cars Land, as well as experienced just about everything that this new land has to offer. Though I'm sure I missed plenty that because it's that's so much to see in there, which is a good sign that you can't see it all in a brief amount of time. But the point is that I can't include it all in one show here. Of course, I don't want to spend week after week talking nothing but Cars Land. But I think I'm going to split this up into two parts. Right now, I'm going to talk a bit about Cars Land, an overview, And its biggest ride. And then next week I'll talk about the remainder of Cars Land. I'm going to sort of talk about what I enjoyed most, what surprised me, and what was most interesting about the new land, including thoughts and some information from Imagineers, top Disney Parks executives, and even a few Cars voice actors that I had a chance to speak to on the grand opening red carpet, and of course plenty of recordings. So those of you who do want to explore even more of Cars Land beyond these podcasts, definitely head on over to InsideTheMagic.net and on our YouTube channel. Continue reading and watching there. I have around 7 or 8 more articles at least planned for Cars Land specifically, so stay tuned for all of that. So first up, I want to share a few marks from the Imagineers that were most closely associated with the Cars Land project. We're going to begin actually with Bob Weis, a name that you may or may not know. He most recently has been working overseas on the Shanghai Disneyland project, but he's been at Walt Disney Imagineering for many, many, many years, worked on many projects over the years, and he was part of the initial team that sort of decided that Disney California Adventure needed help and really put Cars Land into motion 5 years ago. And on grand opening night, I saw him in the crowd. I was up on the riser, you know, shooting video and photos of the opening. And down below, I saw him and other Imagineers standing around watching everything. And they showed a montage up on the screen from the Cars Land announcement years ago and everything that's happened up until then, all the construction, and even showed Bob Weis from years ago up on the screen. And I was watching him watch himself really smiling proudly at the accomplishment, not only his accomplishment, but all the Imagineers. And so when I had a chance to sit down with him the following morning, I really wanted to know what his feelings were at that moment. You know, what does it feel to be an Imagineer, to follow a project from concept all the way through to completion and see it finally done? So let's hear what Mr. Bob Weis, Imagineer Bob Weis, that.
What were you feeling finally the grand opening of Cars Land?
I think it's almost a little unreal actually, because you know we spend so much time talking about renderings and models and you kind of get out there and you there's almost a sense that it'll never be done, you know, that it's construction, and then you know, and then all of a sudden it does actually get done. It does get done, and we have such a interesting set of disciplines between, you know, the largest rock work project we've ever done in the U.S. And we had to bring, it was so big and so complicated, and our artistic desire for it was so high that we had to bring an international group in. We brought some of the best guys we have in Japan and France and to things like that, to getting the ride technology the way we wanted it to work, to getting, you know, things programmed the way we wanted it. It's a big complicated process, and then suddenly, you know, you're standing out there and you look up and you say, wow, it's done, and they light up the street, and nothing's ever done. I mean, we will work with Mary to continue to help refine things the way she needs them to be able to accommodate the audience. We think it's going to be a very busy busy year, certainly, or busy from now on. But the good thing is Cars Land sits on 12 additional acres, so this park really needed more scope. It needed more, you know, that visual scope also.
And Bob Weis referred there to Mary, who was sitting next to her. That was next to him. That was Mary Niven, a VP of Disney California Adventure, and we'll have a few words from her coming up when we talk about Buena Vista Street and the grander picture of Disney California Adventure in the coming weeks. But right now, we're just focusing on Cars Land at the moment, and certainly, you know, very proud Bob Weis and all of the Imagineers that I talked to. Very excited to finally be done with this project. And you know, as I noted, my reaction to Cars Land, my initial reaction when I walked in for the first time, just how immersive it is. I didn't feel like I was in Disney California Adventure anymore. I didn't even feel like I was in Anaheim anymore, or Disneyland, or anywhere else for that matter. I was simply in Radiator Springs. Just the sights that you see when you walk around the area look exactly like you think you would have seen them, you know, if you were in the Cars films. The Cozy Cone Motel, where, of course, Lightning, you know, Sally runs it, and Lightning McQueen, you know, drives up there and reluctantly stays there, et cetera, et cetera. It looks just like that. It looks like you could drive up there if you were a car and stay there. There's, you know, Flo's V8 Cafe. Gorgeous, gorgeous at night with all the neon, and a really excellent place to just plop down and relax. And then, of course, there's the Ornament Valley. Incredible rock work that Weis was just saying, that it was their biggest rock work project ever in the United States. And just simply amazing to see those sights. And just, you know, just walking down the main Radiator Springs, main street, an impressive amount of immersion into this. And it doesn't matter whether you're riding or sitting or eating or walking or you know, it doesn't even have to involve doing something. You could just be sitting and watching people go by, and it just feels like you are somewhere else. In fact, while I was there, the only time that I felt like I was not necessarily in Cars Land but in Disney California Adventures, when you kind of look up and off to the side and you see the Tower of Terror sort of peeking over in the distance. So you know, that's really the only indication as you're walking around that there is something other than Radiator Springs around you. So definitely a very, very impressive creation that the Imagineers have conjured up as a really incredible amount of Disney magic. And of course, there were two Imagineers that have been on top of this project for so many years now, and you've heard from them here on the show before. We've been hearing them for years, whether it's at the D23 Expo or otherwise. They're Kevin Raffery and Kathy Mangum. They've been talking Cars Land to the media and, of course, doing their jobs at Imagineering for many, many years now, making sure that this project got where it finally is today. And, you know, these are the two that we're going to keep referring to over the next little while I'm talking about Cars Land, because I had a chance to sit down with them once again and hear more about sort of where we are in the grand scheme of Cars Land now that it's reached the finish line, to use a racing analogy there. So first, I want to sort of give you, here's what they had to say about this return, in my opinion, to classic Disney theme park storytelling. And really specifically in this case, we're going to be referring to the detailed environment, the highly, highly detailed and immersive environment that is the queue for Radiator Springs Racers, which I'll talk about more in a minute. But just in general terms, here are Imagineers Kevin Raffery and Kathy Mangum talking a bit about that.
First thought that came to mind was, you know, there's this notion of sort of interactive queues and all that sort of thing going on at Walt Disney World, and I walked into that and I'm thinking, that's just not needed. This is sort of classic Imagineering. Is that the feel that you were always going with this?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it was a placemaking. We want that to be a comfortable queue, but we want to, and it's got these beautiful views of the mountain as you take turns and look out windows and stuff, because we know that you're going to probably be in there for a while, so we want you to have things to look at. And there's all that whole layer of storytelling, too, that this is Stanley's Oasis, and this is the origins of Radiator Springs, and of course, you know, is being paired up with the release of Time Travel Meter, the short. So we worked really closely with Pixar on that short. In fact, our queue structures really drove the design of Time Travel Meter.
And the story of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And so people are, you know, we really want them to just sort of get into the whole story.
So just a quick little snippet from that pair of Imagineers, who we'll hear more from in just a few minutes, sort of setting the stage for what, you know, the story that is driving Cars Land and its attractions. And that's what you always hear is most important when it comes to Disney attractions, is that it is indeed all based on story. And it's great to see Imagineering continuing with that when it comes to Cars Land, not even just recreating what was seen in the Cars and Cars 2 movies. Really, this is, in this case, there's just Cars elements, not so much Cars 2, but it's not just a recreation of the movie, but also a continuation of that, and really elaborating on that story, which is, you know, a wonderful thing to sort of experience that, take what you already know about the Cars universe and move on even further into Radiator Springs and all of it. So what of the Cars Land specifics? You know, what works, what doesn't, what are the tips, where are there areas for improvement? Sort of the good news is that it's, in my opinion, it's nearly perfect. I'm sure there are things to tweak here and there, but the translation of Radiator Springs in the film to what's in the theme park is just spot on. And one of the ways you can really sort of note that is as you're walking around in the area, it's not jam-packed with something every 2 feet. There are details and there are sort of empty spaces with little to nothing in them, and those are just as important as those areas that are packed with things to do. As Mangum said, it's all about the placemaking, and it's not a, you know, nonstop barrage of entertainment, but rather a sort of a casual stroll through the land in which the guest can decide what's entertaining, what's interesting to them, as if traveling to a real city for the first time. Of course, most guests are going to go straight for the rides and want those to be the experience, but there will be those who either have ridden the rides a bunch of times and looking for more, or those who just want to, you know, simply enjoy being there as a new place to experience and enjoy in life. And it really gives you that opportunity to do whatever it is that you want to amidst the area. So taking a step back here and talking about in general what Cars Land is all about, of course, there are many components to Cars Land. It's not just a ride, it is all of Radiator Springs. So you know, within that are three rides. There's of course Mater's Junkyard Jamboree, which is going to be first immediately on the left as you enter into Cars Land. And that attraction, I'll talk much more about it later, but it's definitely a fun little attraction. As you move further from there, actually really across from Mater's Junkyard Jamboree, you'll find Fillmore's Taste Inn. That's on the right side of the road, and you'll get some drinks and some snacks there, and it looks just like it does in the film. Very, very hippie, very very tie-dyed looking. Moving next door to that is Sarge's Surplus Hut on the right side of the road as well. Very different from Fillmore's. They're next to each other, and of course they're drastically different, as they should be, from those characters in the film. Looks very very army like a big iron structure that's you know, rusty, and it's got the yellows and the greens and all that sort of arminess to it. Next to that is Flo's VA Cafe, and that just looks gorgeous. As I said, it's neon at night is spectacular, but even during the day, it's got this wonderful sense about it that really transports you even to another place within Radiator Springs. Across from that, the Cozy Cone Motel, a great place to get some food and to just explore, and that's where I've seen Lightning McQueen doing some meet and greets there quite frequently. Next to that, on the left side of the road, Radiator Springs Curios, a little shop, and then you kind of come to a crossroads at that point. And that crossroads could take you down to the Ornament Valley mountain range, but if you stick on with the main road of Radiator Springs, then you'll find yourself on the left side to Luigi's Flying Tires, or rather Luigi's Casa de la Tires from the film. And that's where another fun little ride is that I'll talk about a bit later. Across from that, on the right side of the road, is Ramon's, which is another store within Cars Land. And then after a couple of little facades, you finally make your way to the end of the main road of Radiator Springs at City Hall with the statue of Stanley. And, you know, it's all laid out exactly, I'm sure as I'm talking about this, you can picture it from Radiator Springs in the movie, and it's exactly like that. It's down to the tiniest detail, you know, the tiniest sign, the pieces of artwork, and it's really made to work, of course, in a theme park environment. There's appropriate directional signs and wait times and benches and restrooms and all that kind of thing, but really, it's all about recreating that Radiator Springs experience that you would think as if you were really going there. And now there are two ways to enter into Cars Land. Really, there's the main entrance that you can imagine walking into the front, the end of the road of Radiator Springs. When you make that approach up Route 66 and you look into the area, that is certainly a great way to enter. It's the way that the whole city is laid out in front of you. You've got the Cadillac Range in the distance with City Hall in front of it and all the stores and restaurants and rides and everything on the left and the right side of this main Radiator Springs street. But that is not necessarily You know, it's definitely an inviting view. It's making you want to explore it all. It makes you want to enter in and explore it all. But the majority of the monumental mountain range that's constructed for Radiator Springs Racers is completely hidden from view at that point. The amount of that massive area that's hidden from your sight lines from there is really impressive. It's really a different sort of area. There's almost two zones to Cars Land. There's the Radiator Springs main town, and then off to the side, down that crossroads, as I said, is where you'll find the rest of Ornament Valley and the Radiator Springs Racers part, and that is the area. If you enter through the Pacific Wharf area of Disney California Adventure, that is where you will find the most stunning view in all of Cars Land. This is the side that you really should see Cars Land from for the first time, because the approach there is just unbelievable. There's this rockwork archway that you walk through, and particularly at night, it's absolutely incredible, and obviously the music thinks so too. It's just quite the view as you're walking down the road and pass through the archway and see the incredible, massive rockwork that Disney Imagineering has put together, and the talented artists, and it's all part of the ride, and it just is unbelievable as the cars are speeding by, and the butte is rising up in the middle, and a giant waterfall cascading in the distance, and it just extends far down this side street. And is absolutely impressive. And I'm certainly not the only one to be impressed by this site and thinking that side of Cars Land is the way to go when entering it on the red carpet for the grand opening of Cars Land. I had a chance to chat briefly with Disneyland Resort President George Kalogridis, and you know what? He agreed that is the way to enter Cars Land. I asked him about that and a little bit more about Cars Land. So here is what Mr. Kalogridis had to say.
What is your expectation for when the first guests walk in? I'm sure they'll be lining up starting tomorrow night, but when they walk in and see Cars Land Friday morning, are their minds just going to be blown?
I think so, yeah. I think, and especially if you go in the entrance with the arch into Radiator Springs, I mean, every guest that I've taken there, they just stand there and they just, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. So then we know we've done it right.
And when the president of the Disneyland Resort feels that something is done right and that's the way to experience it, perhaps that's the best way to do it. And you know, it's certainly the way that I think is an amazing sight, an amazing part of Cars Land. And the most amazing aspect of that incredible archway entrance into Cars Land is that I found out it wasn't entirely an intentional part from the initial design, or of the initial design of Cars Land from the very beginning. It's sort of that archway mimics the act of passing under the train station at Disneyland, you know, revealing Town Square and Main Street and the castle at the end of Main Street. But if it turns out, if it wasn't for one particular part of the Disneyland Resort, that archway may not actually exist, and I will let Imagineer Kathy Mangum tell you that story of how the archway.
So many people who say walking down Radiator Springs, great, but walking through that archway, phenomenal. Did you have that in mind sort of when you were designing that was going to be the wow moment?
No, not really. We built that arch because you had a beautiful view of the Paradise Pier Hotel from the Camelback humps, and that's the beauty of designing things first in the virtual world. Mm-hmm. And when we were riding the ride, and we put, you know, virtually, and we put surrounding buildings.
2 minute warning. 2 minutes.
We had that view, and we cannot have that view. So we built an arch to block the view. And then one day in the model, as we were walking, I just looked through the model, going the other direction. Like, oh, you guys!
You gotta see this.
We are framing the Cadillac fins beautifully. Yeah.
So you know, one of those happy accidents at Walt Disney Imagineering. Really not even an accident so much as out of necessity. You certainly wouldn't want to ruin the atmosphere, the immersiveness of being in Cars Land by seeing the hotel in the distance, so then they had to throw that archway in there, and the rest is history. So one of those things that is wonderful that it happened. Now, I would love to spend the time taking and talking all the way through all of the shops and the restaurants and the rides and, you know, the order that they appear while walking down the main street of Radiator Springs here, but I suspect that it's really Radiator Springs Racers that everybody everybody wants to hear my thoughts on first. It is, after all, home to the huge Ornament Valley Mountain Range that I was just talking about that you see through that archway. It's also exactly where pretty much every visitor to Cars Land immediately heads first, despite the fact that the entrance is all the way in the back. You have to pass all the way through Radiator Springs to get to the entrance to Radiator Springs Racers, but that's exactly where everybody goes. It's Disney's big new e-ticket attraction, and there's a very good reason for everybody going there, because it's not only the single most impressive part of Cars Land, but it's also one of the most impressive attractions Disney quite possibly has ever created. What makes Radiator Springs Racers so unique is really a variety of concepts that blend perfectly together. It's thrilling enough for anyone to get excited about, but not so thrilling that it prevents young or timid guests from riding. It's slow and relaxing at times with gorgeous scenery, as I've extensively said here. You just can't get enough of that Ornament Valley area and watching those cars go whizzing by. But in addition to sort of that thrilling element, it has those classic Disney storytelling elements from the winding queue that begins, real subtly with some welcome to Radiator Springs signs, and this queue takes you through this story of Stanley's Oasis, Stanley being the founder of Radiator Springs, and you wind through this really elaborate, gorgeous queue that, it sets the stage without having queue videos or interactivity or any of that sort of current queue, I don't know, nonsense, if you will. It just simply works in telling a story for those who want to pay attention by reading the signs and listening to the music and looking at the scenery, and it's just a sort of a perfect blend of the atmosphere and being immersed into this new and unique environment that Walt Disney Imagineering has created. Now, the backstory of Radiator Springs, the town, as well as Radiator Springs Racers, are kind of one and the same. This was not really told in the movie Cars. You know a bit about how Radiator Springs came about and how Stanley was their founder. You see the statue in front of City Hall, but you don't know all the little details, and it all sort of is now unfolding in the queue of Radiator Springs Racers and uniting with the new Cars tune called Time Travel Mater, which was created to be in conjunction with Cars Land. And really, I want to once again go back to Imagineer Kevin Raffery, and rather than me sort of telling the story of Radiator Springs Racers and what is behind that, I would much rather let him be the one to do it, because, well, he's one of the ones who helped write it, of course, with John Lasseter and everybody else on the team. And anyway, so here he is once again, Imagineer Kevin Raffery.
Tells the story about Stanley, the radiator cap salesman who blew his radiator cap coming across the desert in 1909, the founder of Radiator Springs, and that he happened upon the natural spring, nature's coolant. And that's as far as they took the story. That's as far as they needed to for the movie.
They had a few sketches.
And so we were able to take that story further. What would Stanley have done when he arrived? And, he's a radiator cap salesman, so he built the cap and tap to help travelers coming up from Route 66, just like himself. And that became such a successful business that he built the service garage next door. Back in those days, oil changes were with bottles, so he saved up all the bottles. And being the kind of the Route 66 show car that he was, trying to get people off the road for a roadside attraction, he built the amazing oil bottle house, and then he built the Comfy Caverns Motor Court, which was right next door to the entrance of Tail Light Caverns. It was a perfect little place.
And it's a real Route 66 story, too. You see little establishments and settlements like that along the road.
Yeah.
So it really was fun playing with that and getting a lot of inspiration from Route 66.
It was. And, I'm from the world that the Pixar created and established, and we were able to expand on that and complement that. And I think one of the greatest things I heard last night is somebody was going through that queue area, which is Stanley's Oasis, and they looked around and they said, "This is so Disney."
And that is indeed the key right there for anybody to walk through the queue, and I certainly did just that, and think this is so Disney, and that's exactly what it is. It's definitely classic Imagineering, classic Disney storytelling that, just takes you and puts you into this environment without forcing it on you. And as you're moving through there, of course, eventually you do get to the loading area of the ride, and at that point, whether or not you decided to pay attention to the story that was being presented around you with Stanley's Oasis and all the signage and read all the little details and look at the different environments that you walk through as you're walking through the queue, whether or not you paid attention to any of that, the ride itself is going to be thoroughly entertaining for absolutely everybody that rides it. Radiator Springs Racers brings the world of cars to life via incredible audio animatronics figures that really surprise everybody that's on it for the first time and how lifelike they are. And I'll just go ahead and put the note in here real quick. If you're trying to remain spoiler-free about this ride, which I kind of encourage, if you haven't seen it, if you haven't watched videos of it, et cetera, if you don't want to know, this will be the time to kind of tune out here for a little while, because I am going to be talking in some detail about this attraction. So with that said, you know, many guests think Radiator Springs Racers, from being around the Cars Land area, is only the outdoor portion, the sort of thrilling portion where the cars are seen zipping around the track, but that certainly couldn't be further from the truth. Of course, that is an integral part of the attraction and the part that attracts everybody to the attraction, but that's only, and I timed this, it's only 45 seconds of this 4-minute ride is spent in that part of the ride. That's only 1/5 of the ride. The rest is a combination of slow and speedy and twists and turns and in and out and close encounters with many familiar characters in the Cars universe. Not every character, obviously. There's hundreds and hundreds of characters, but every major character's in there. Lightning McQueen, Mater, Sally, Sheriff, Ramon, Flo, Fillmore, Sarge, Red, Luigi, Guido, Mac, etc., etc. All the major characters are there, including the triumphant return of Doc Hudson, who, of course, was absent from Cars 2 due to the unfortunate death of actor Paul Newman. Not all the cars in the ride are voiced by the original actors, but most are, and they absolutely look exactly as they do in the film. To scale, eyes are blinking, mouths are moving, really impressive mouths are forming words, and for a little tech note here, some of the mouths are digital projections, and some of them are animatronic mouths, depending on the character, but they always look fantastic. Some of the characters kind of stay in place. Some of them are, you know, just gesturing and sort of bobbing their bodies back and forth. Some of them actually drive up to you or along with you. And best of all, they are real. They're there. They're not virtual characters. They're not screens. You're riding in a car's character yourself in the ride vehicle, and then they're talking to you in person right there on race day. You know, it's a fast-paced ride, but it feels like a nice long ride. The 4 minutes is a great length. You know, it sounds a little bit short, but the ride has a clear beginning, middle, and an end, and it's just totally satisfying and simply a fun, you know, really, really enjoyable attraction. So rather than me blabbing on and on, how about we go for a spin on Radiator Springs Racers? You don't have to wait 6 hours in line for this particular ride here. Instead, you can hop in a car with me and enjoy a trip on here, which means you can see all the scenes, and there's actually a little bit extra at the end as well, because at one point, really in order to send all of the cars in Radiator Springs Racers through all of the same scenes and then have them race at the end, they have to, of course, catch up alongside one another as they're traveling sort of back to back for the majority, as you know, vehicles generally do in rides. So the track course actually splits left and right at one point into two different show scenes, and so the ride that you're about to enjoy here will feature one entire ride with one of those show scenes, and then after it's over, it's going to backtrack a little bit to the other pre-race scene as well. So don't be confused when the ride ends and then it resumes, etc., etc. And naturally, this ride features binaural audio, so you definitely want to wear your headphones for the most sort of realistic and best experience, to put you right in the middle of Ornament Valley. So once again, if you're trying to remain spoiler free, this is about a 4-minute ride or so that it'll give you time to go grab a snack or just kind of fast forward through the show or whatever you need to do. But short of that, get ready to experience Disney's latest and greatest e-ticket attraction. It is Radiator Springs Racers.
Thank you.
Hey, you ever gone track a ticket? It's easy. Just sneak up on him and honk. Ready? Don't let Frank catch you. On this planet.
Hippie.
What's race day?
It's Radiator Springs.
What do we need to be fast?
You need to look fast. Ka-chow!
So there you have it, Radiator Springs Racers, the biggest and newest and most impressive Disney attraction, which I just absolutely loved everything about it. Such an exciting and exhilarating and entertaining and just wonderfully perfect attraction there is around. Even me, as a not so big fan of the Cars universe, seeing all of it come to life before you, you just can't help but smile. And watching people for their very first ride on this attraction is just the most entertaining thing around, because everybody is just, you know, during that race portion near the end, just putting your hands up and screaming and yelling. And you look at the car opposite you, and you know, you pull up next to each other and you say, "You're going down," and you just, you know, you race along next to each other. And it's so much fun to, it's such a unique experience to be zipping around the track side by side with other guests and just enjoying it throughout. And then of course there's all the animatronic scenes and just everything. It's just so very, very entertaining. And unlike many newer rides that Disney's you know, come out with recently that involve massive screens or 3D visuals, you know, videos online, actually kind of surprisingly do a decent job of showing what Radiator Springs Racers really is like. Of course, no video online or audio recording or anything that you'll ever have or see or experience it will beat the actual experience of seeing it in person. It is now Disney's must-see attraction for all the reasons that I mentioned. Thrills and fun and family-friendly and comedy, enjoyable characters, great music, and amazing sights. Throughout the days I was there, I had a chance to ride it, I think, a total of 5 times. I probably could have ridden it more, but I had so much else to do, and I couldn't just spend my entire time riding this one ride over and over. Not once in those 5 times did I actually win a race. These randomized Disney attractions seem to have a curse for me. I still have not seen pod racing at Star Tours, and I still have not won a race on Radiator Springs Racers, but that gives me something to look forward to, I suppose. That includes, actually, the times I went around, that includes a special time that I went around. I actually rode alongside Imagineer and the creative director for Radiator Springs Racers, Tom Morris. And I would like to share something very special with you now, much like my on-ride interview on The Little Mermaid when it opened last year, Ariel's Undersea Adventure, Disney California Adventure. I had a chance to chat with Imagineer Tom Morris while riding Radiator Springs Racers. Unlike The Little Mermaid, though, which is, of course, a long, slow-moving indoor dark ride, Radiator Springs Racers is fast-paced and very loud throughout the whole thing, so it was kind of a fun challenge to have and hold a solid conversation with Morris as I, during the 4 minutes that we rode, trying to kind of learn details about the ride's creation. I think it turned out great. I think it was fun, and I do want to share that with you. Now, Morris was on the team that developed everything leading up to the actual construction of the ride. That is, he worked on pre-visualization ride-throughs, some of which you've probably seen that I've shared, that have been presented to the media in recent years, or maybe you saw it at the D23 Expo. He also aided in the timing of sort of each of the show scenes and their elements, ensuring the maximum number of riders could go through in the shortest time possible, but also keeping it entertaining. So now we're going to go back and hop on Radiator Springs Racers a second time, except this time we will be sitting, or at least I will be sitting, and you'll be along for the ride next to Imagineer Tom Morris, so we can learn more about the creation of this fantastic new attraction at Disney California Adventure.
Riding Radiator Springs Racers with Imagineer Tom Morris, who is the creative director of this amazing new attraction in Cars Land. As you're riding through here, I know you worked a lot on the pre-visualization of this attraction. What does it feel like actually riding it finally?
It's fantastic. It's really great. It's gratifying. I still get goosebumps at this moment here.
Right. It's gorgeous.
We planned it exactly to do that.
For the amazing waterfall reveal.
Yeah, exactly.
How long ago did you start working on this attraction?
Over 5 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it takes a long time to do something this complicated.
So this is a huge attraction. Yeah. Where did sort of the basis of it come, and how early in the process did you know it was going to be so massive?
Pretty early. Before I joined, there was some pre-work done by Kevin Raffery and Robert Coltrane, who had kind of gotten the ball rolling on it. And then they brought me along to start laying it out.
As we move into this interior portion, the sort of dark ride portion of the attraction, it surprises a lot of people that there's so much in here. It's not just the outdoor racing. I know you worked a lot on the dialogue and the music. Can you tell me a little bit about sort of the mixing of everything to create the experience?
Well, we're on a 12-second dispatch interval in this attraction, and that's very aggressive.
Yeah.
Many attractions have much longer intervals, so that meant the dialogue had to be really pithy. It had to get the message across.
So you see Nader, he says, here's tractor tipping, now you're moving on.
That's right. We started off with a much longer dialogue stem. And had to pare him down and get the music just right.
Right.
And show action equipment, animated props, all of those things had to be worked out. Because your real envelope is really only about 7 or 8 seconds.
Okay.
Even though the dispatch interval is 12.
Sure, and then we move into sort of now, though, we take it down a notch. It's not quite as hectic here.
That's right.
And we get to drive through Radiator Springs. It's interesting that you go through Radiator Springs out in the real world, and now again in the attraction.
The fantasy version.
Right.
The fantasy within the fantasy.
And it's great that we're going through Ramones. I haven't been through here yet. I went through Luigi's last time. So. Now, was it because of the racing component that you decided to split it like this?
Absolutely. It also gave us the luxury of 24-second long scenes where we could do something a little more elaborate, like have our tires changed and the other actually come to a stop.
And I love the fact that Doc Hudson is in the ride. Clearly, this world of Cars Land is in the original Cars. Because Cars 2, obviously, Doc Hudson has moved on. So.
That's right.
Now we're approaching
everything in the movie and more.
Yep. Now, what can you tell me about the racing portion of this? Obviously, it's very, very fun.
It goes very fast.
Yeah, very fast.
And it's the fastest ride at Disneyland Resort. And we're dealing with things we haven't dealt with before, like steep tanks.
How does the actual racing component work on this? Where, you know, when is it decided that one car is going to beat the other?
There's an algorithmic program that kind of works it all out. It's semi-random. It's actually not random, but...
Now we're entering the
Caverns, which is kind of a new world that we introduce.
And this has a bit of Disneyland history to it,
doesn't
it?
It does. It was inspired, of course, by the Rainbow Caverns.
Now, riding through, as we come to the conclusion here, what impresses you most from working on this for so many years, now that it's finally, you know, exists in the real world?
I think just the massiveness of it and the placemaking of the exterior, you know, the rock work, and the fact that you kind of go, it's three rides in one. You know, it's a great road trip,
right,
and it's a wonderful encounter with the characters and special effects,
yeah,
and then it's a great race, a great thrill adventure.
Definitely,
and
yeah,
we didn't know whether the public would buy that. You know, it's like, that's too much, you know?
Is it a thrill ride? Is it a dark ride?
Exactly.
But it blends them all very, very well.
I think it does.
And
I think it
does. The believability of the animated characters, you know, brought into this 3D space, real world space.
Believability is the key to everything, you know, because you can go overboard with fantasy. And
yeah,
John Lasseter has always been very, passionate about research, about researching the authenticity and the placemaking. And that's why we took the Route 66 trip. Which out of that came so many other great ideas, but they're lodged in some kind of reality that has a familiarity to it, that brings a connection to people. Even the Tail Light Caverns, as you said, has some connections not only to Disneyland, but to Carlsbad Caverns and things that you would expect to find along the road on a vacation.
And yet it's in this world of cars, which is humorous and fun.
That's
And you know, all of that. Yeah. So Radiator Springs Racers, now open in Cars Land at Disney California Adventure at the Disneyland Resort. Tom, thanks for chatting with me.
Come out and ride it.
Absolutely. It's very fun.
And there it is, my second ever on-ride interview on a Disney attraction, and what better attraction to do it than the new Radiator Springs Racers. Tom Morris, definitely an excellent guy. I talked to him for quite a few minutes while waiting to board the ride, and he had so much passion to share for creating this amazing attraction, and that was clear from every Imagineer that I talked to over the last few days that, you know, Radiator Springs Racers certainly came out of a tremendous amount of, you know, it's not just work. It is a passion for what they do. They really, truly enjoy it, and it shows when an attraction like this comes out. You know, the most interesting figure that I think came out of that conversation with Tom Morris was that each indoor scene is designed to get riders in and out in 12 seconds. That means every 12 seconds, the sheriff comes out to tell a car to slow down. Every 12 seconds, Mater goes and tips tractors. Every 12 seconds, the cars split into Luigi's and Ramon's, and then they actually spend 24 seconds in each of those scenes, which allows the cars to kind of catch up side by side, and the timing is even further impressive there because the Doc Hudson scene as crew chief actually alternates between the sides of the track, left and right, every 12 seconds as one car passes through and the other, and then it ultimately all comes together to form one cohesive experience. Just a master full amount of timing involved in this 4-minute attraction where something is going on over and over and over and over for so long. Really, really impressive. And, you know, when details of Radiator Springs Racer's top speed first came out and was revealed to be, you know, somewhere in roughly the 30s, kind of topping out at close to 40 miles an hour, despite using the same basic ride vehicle and track technology as Test Track in Epcot, which tops out at around 60 plus miles an hour. Many Disney fans were wondering if Radiator Springs Racers would be thrilling. And even with the slower speeds, I can say it most definitely is thrilling and exciting, particularly at night. You know, the ride system is used wonderfully. It's smooth, and whether it's around slow turns or quick turns or up and down hills or around those heavily banked corners through Ornament Valley, and especially racing around the huge Ornament Valley, it's so much more impressive than just racing around that steel structure that is around Test Track. It's really no wonder that Disney is reinventing Test Track at Epcot, because otherwise the comparisons that would be made between this new amazing Radiator Springs Racers and the old Test Track would certainly make Test Track just simply look old and undesirable. So, Test Track will have a dramatic improvement in the future. As for the winners of the race around Ornament Valley, as Morris said, it is sort of semi-randomized using some sort of algorithm to choose. And winners don't really see any different scenes, so it doesn't matter if you win the race or not. Doc, you get a little bit of a different message from Doc Hudson whether you win or you don't, with a little congratulations. But other than sort of crossing the finish line just barely first, and of course giving you the honor of ragging on the other car as you slowly tour through the taillight caverns at the end, you don't really get anything, a different experience whether you win or lose, so it doesn't really matter. And that final scene featuring a Mater and Lightning Queen has a few different bits of dialogue I've noticed in riding multiple times, so it's fun to ride through over and over to kind of get a different, experience. And so it doesn't matter if you're the winner of the race or the loser of the race. Anybody and everybody who rides Radiator Springs Racers is indeed a winner. And I must say that the voice actors that have contributed to the world of Cars tended to agree. I had a chance to talk to several of the Cars voice actors on the red carpet at the Cars Land grand opening about their roles in the Cars universe, and specifically about Cars Land and, of course, Radiator Springs Racers. So I want to share a few of those quick conversations with you now, starting with a very personable Jenifer Lewis, who you may or may not know that name, but I can tell you you'll certainly know her character as Flo of Flo's V8 Cafe. So let's hop on over to the red carpet that was rolled through Disney California Adventure and chat a bit with Miss AKA Flo.
Hello, it's at the Magic.
So a very exciting night here, grand opening of Cars Land.
Absolutely. I am the voice of Flo, and Flo's V8 Cafe will become legendary like every other Disney institution, and I am so excited to be part of it.
Have you been inside the real-life Flo's V8 Cafe yet?
I've been inside, yeah. I had me a milkshake. They're delicious.
And in exploring Cars Land, other than Flo's V8 Cafe, yes, what did you think of Radiator Springs brought to life?
Well, I have to tell you, I saw a man like he was moving a little gravel over. Talk about detail. The love that went into this whole thing. I mean, as soon as you walk in there, you feel it. So I say to all these kids, come on out, get another experience down here.
Now, how much of your own personality is in Flo? Obviously, I can hear there's a pretty strong connection there.
A lot of Jennifer Lewis is in Flo. I have to admit that. But Jennifer Lewis doesn't walk around with the nasal there. When she goes, gas, I got lots of gas. I don't talk like that.
I remember Flo being pretty close to Ramon in the film.
Oh, Flo loves Ramon. It's a man, honey. Oh, what is it? Low and slow?
were you hanging around with Cheech? I saw him walking around a little bit.
We've been hanging out with Cheech. He's so funny and so wonderful. He really is. He's a funny guy. I mean, the online premiere of the games, the Cars game,
right?
We clowned so bad on that red carpet.
Yeah.
They've got pictures of us just looking like we're in a mental institution. We just had so much fun. That's what this is all about. It's fun. So it's what it's all about.
Absolutely.
There you go. A little bit from the very personable Jennifer Lewis. Moving on now to another recognizable figure in the Cars universe, in the Pixar universe, John Ratzenberger. I had a chance to very, very briefly ask a couple of quick questions to him, and he offered some very amusing responses.
Obviously, you've been sort of Pixar's golden boy. How did that get started? How did you get involved with every single Pixar film?
Well, I've got a Polaroid from a New Year's Eve party that some of the Pixar executives were at. Anyway, I can't tell you anymore.
Wait, so what did you think of Radiator Springs?
It's like stepping into a movie. I've never seen anything like it in my life.
And at the end of Cars, there's a pretty humorous blooper reel running through all your voices. Do you feel like there's a lot of laughs to be found throughout all your various characters over the years?
Jeez, I hope so.
So, as I said, a very, very short conversation there with Mr. John Ratzenberger, but also a very, very entertaining guy. He had a lot of interviews to do, as you can imagine, along the red carpet, so he had to keep moving along. And then I had a chance to talk to one more very notable name from the Cars universe, Larry, the cable guy, of course, Mater himself. And, you know, he actually skipped me a little bit on the red carpet because he made a beeline straight to the mini ear wearing Japanese journalist next to me. And I can't help but share her interview here, too, because before I jumped in to talk to him, because it's simply too funny not to. So we'll start with her Japanese interview with him and then mine to follow.
There are so many Mater fans in Japan.
I'm going to have to make it out there at some point. That's cool. You should make sure they come see this.
Yeah, definitely.
The cars on it.
Have you traveled on Route 66?
I have traveled on Route 66. Yes, I have. I enjoyed it.
Would you recommend it to your Japanese?
Yeah, of course I would. Yeah, it's the part. It's American history. Yeah, it is Americana. So if you want a good piece of Americana, you go down Route 66 and you see exactly how it was back in the 40s and the 50s. It's awesome. It's really cool. And when you go in Radiator Springs in there, I'm telling you, John told a story yesterday. Some little kid said to his dad, hey, is this where they filmed the movie? Because it is. You are in Radiator Springs. You would never know the difference. It's awesome. It's the coolest thing ever. Now, you got to get all everybody in Japan out there saying, get her done. How do you say get her done in Japanese?
Yachimae.
What is it?
Yachimae.
Yachimae. Yachimae. Yeah, that's pretty good right there. I hope I make it over there one
Larry,
day.
Larry,
just get a quick one over here.
One quick question?
Just.
Larry, one quick question.
Question here?
One question. How much of Mater is in Larry the Cable Guy, and how much of Larry the Cable Guy is in Mater?
My wife says a lot of me is in Mater. She does. That's what my wife says. But, you know, Mater, a lot of it really is. Yeah. Look, you have to know something about the character to breathe life into it. So I think I did a good job. I'm glad John trusted me with the character, and I love Mater. Mater's awesome. Mater's a friend that everybody should have. You know what I mean? He's just awesome. I love doing him. He's great.
What do you think about meeting Mater in person here at Cars Land?
Oh, man, that's pretty cool. I went over to took pictures and everything. It's pretty awesome. My little boy was a little confused, though, but it's pretty cool. Yeah, it's awesome. It's awesome to see Mater sitting there in the town. It's pretty neat. You can't describe it. It's great.
As you can hear, red carpets can be tough and hectic, but are always fun. Everyone walking the carpet surely shared some excitement for Cars Land. I could tell all the celebrities and executives were having a great time. I of course, talked to Disneyland President George Kalogridis there. We heard from him earlier, but I also asked him about his own personal experiences with Radiator Springs Racers.
How many times have you been through Radiator Springs Racers already?
It's not... probably triple digits, yeah. But, I mean, you know, I think that's also one of the great things. It's a thrill ride, but it's pretty much a thrill ride that almost everybody in the family can go on. It has great story, and part of, you know, the great part of my job is you sort of have to help develop it along the way, so that's been fun, too.
And even those who aren't directly involved in the Pixar and Cars universe were enjoying themselves on the red carpet. I had just one quick question to ask Vincent Martella of Phineas and Ferb fame. Of course, he is the voice of Phineas. He was there dressed in an Oswald the Lucky Rabbit shirt on the red carpet. And here is what he had to offer. Pretty amusing.
I think you know Phineas pretty well.
I know Phineas relatively well, you know, sort of.
A little bit. What do you think Phineas would think of Cars Land and all the animated characters in there?
I think if Phineas were here, and this, I'm just spitballing here. If Phineas was here, oh my goodness, Cars Land was incredible. I don't know why me and Ferb didn't think of it first. I mean, we love cars. We love cars. We've raced them before, but a land devoted to cars, that is really cool.
Always fun when voice actors do their voices spontaneously, just out of nowhere, particularly when it's a Disney voice like that. Pretty fun there. So, you know, that that level of excitement really continued well past that grand opening night onto the faces of every single rider who made it into Radiator Springs Racers, even with very, very long waits, occasional technical difficulties, some downtime. Everyone seemed to stay very happy. Cast members kept Cars Land opened well into the early morning to accommodate those who were in line. Of course, the park closed at 11 p.m., but the lights stayed lit and the stores stayed open until nearly 2 a.m. as those already in line continued to make their way through, while friends and family members or anyone who wanted to stick around in Cars Land were free to wander, snapping photos, shooting video, shopping, or just hanging around. You know, Radiator Springs Racers will certainly remain a huge draw for Disney California Adventure, as will all of Cars Land for quite some time. It's certainly not the only attraction of Cars Land. After all, Imagineering didn't build just a single Cars attraction, but an entire area devoted to it, and for good reason. You know, Radiator Springs in the Cars films was built with rich, detailed settings and characters to go with them, but all of that is a tale for another podcast. We'll save that for week number two of Cars Land coverage, where I'll talk about Mater's Junkyard Jamboree, Luigi's Flying Tires, all the stores, and all the wonderful, wonderful food that is to be found throughout Cars Land, since this week's show is already very, very long. We'll save that for next week. So hopefully you've enjoyed part one of Cars Land coverage. Of course, in addition to Cars Land, there's much to be talked about. The rededication of Disney California Adventure and Buena Vista Street and all its attractions and stores and wonderful things to eat. There is so much more to share, and we'll be covering all of that in the coming weeks. But that's it for Cars Land for this week.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Ricky, this is amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Inside the Magic, listener feedback.
And I bet you thought I was going to wrap up the show there, huh? But no, I figured I'd throw in a little bit of listener feedback because I've gotten so many emails over the last few days while I've been gone that if I saved them this week and I got even more and even more, it would just build up far too much. So let's just jump right into it. I'll do a few emails, try to get to as many as possible, and then we'll wrap up the show. So first, coming in from Sam. Sam writes, thanks for your wonderful podcast. Helps me to keep in the Disney bubble when I can't be there in person, especially thank you for including the detailed Disney news in your podcast. Your podcast gave me a heads up for both the D23 Fanniversary and the Fantasy Christening, both of which I very much enjoyed attending here in New York City. Keep up the good work. Sam, I'm so glad to hear that. I love getting emails like that letting me know that I was able to pass along information about upcoming events and then you got to attend them. That's fantastic. I'm personally looking forward to attending the D23 Fanniversary coming up very, very soon here in Orlando to check out what that is all about as well. Next, an email from Mary, who writes, I'm here to email you a question my sister's friend has about Disney World. She's going to the World on Thanksgiving Day, and her and her family were wondering if there's any type of special events or meal services that go on the actual day of Thanksgiving that they could attend. Mary, absolutely. If you go to Thanksgiving, well, first, let me tell you, it's going to be very, very crowded in the parks, but if you do go to Magic Kingdom, you will find some Thanksgiving service there. They do serve, you know, the turkey and the stuffing and all of that kind of thing at select restaurants. So yes, don't worry, you're not going to miss, or your sister or your sister's friend or whoever it is that's going is not going to miss out on Thanksgiving. It's available all over Walt Disney World Resort. So definitely a possibility for you to enjoy. Next up, an email from Mike from Virginia. He says, from Virginia, at least for now, and says, number one, this is actually in response to some recent listener feedback questions. He writes, regarding the Magical Moments light-up pins, I can confirm that they do, in fact, still work. People are so curious and amazed when our pins go off in the park, whether in a land or during a ride, such as the beating heart effect in the Haunted Mansion. We still love every moment that they go off, so much so that we went on eBay to buy some backup replacements in case ours ever die. Number two, I think your listeners should totally include Swan and Dolphin in their Disney Hotel goal. Michael Eisner initiated the construction of the resort. The Imagineers worked on the story that themes the architecture. It is an elaborately themed area and a great location for staying, and you're correct, the food there is great. And number three, okay, this isn't a piece of information, it's a question. My wife's job will be relocating to the Orlando area. which will greatly aid with our Disney addiction. Do you have any suggestions on areas to look for homes? We've heard good things about Windermere and Dr. Phillips. There are so many towns that we need to focus in our home search. Mike, thanks very much for the information for number one and number two. Great to know that the Magical Moments pins do still work. They, you know, they're very similar, sort of in technology-wise, to the glow-with-the-show ears that I talked about earlier. So good to know that those work. And Swan and Dolphin, I've actually got a couple of more emails I'm going to share here in a minute, echoing your opinions there. As for number three, I get this question a lot, and it's why I wanted to include it here on the show. A lot of people, of course, love Disney, listen to the show, and want to move here to the Orlando area. And yes, you're right, Dr. Phillips and Windermere are definitely nice areas. I live in Winter Garden. Also, I would recommend living here. In fact, those are really three areas that I would recommend probably most of all that are close around Disney. Definitely sounds like you're narrowing your home search into the right area. And next up, an email from Ashley, who writes, let me say, I'm a former Disney cast member, love your podcast, and I wanted to respond to your listener email from the last show about the Swan and Dolphin hotels. I currently work for Starwood Hotels, which owns and operates the last two, or operates the two resorts, and due to my employee discount, I've been staying there instead of Disney recently. There are definitely pros and cons to the properties. The pros would have to be the location. They're right between Epcot and the studios. You don't have to pay for a deluxe resort such as Boardwalk or Beach Club to enjoy being able to walk to the parks. And second, they have far more spacious rooms than any Disney resort I've been in. Many of them offer king bedrooms, which I have yet to experience in a value property. You also get Disney property benefits such as extra magic hours and park-to-park transportation on the buses. Both properties have cheaper rates during slower seasons, which Disney can't really do too often. Negative, of course, is not actually being at a Disney property. I miss a lot of the Disney decor and find myself wandering into properties around Disney to get my fill of it. Also, you have to pay for parking at the resort, which is kind of annoying since Disney, any Disney property is free. Honestly, if I didn't get the discount, I don't know if I'd choose Swan or Dolphin over Disney property, but the location certainly can't be beat, and they do have excellent service, and it's worth a shot if you find a good deal. Ashley, thanks very much for all of that. As I said last week when this came up, I have not stayed at the Swan or Dolphin, so it's good to hear a bit more insight. And continuing on that thought, we have Katie writing in also, who says, this is in response to the email about Swan and Dolphin. My husband, six-month-old son, and I had the opportunity to stay in the Swan last December for a quick three-night trip. We absolutely loved our stay there. The cast members who work there are just as courteous and outgoing as Disney cast members you'll find on property. When I walked in, I instantly felt like I was at Disney. I got that magical feeling, as I have from any other on-property hotels that I've stayed in. Also, the location is great. It's close enough to walk over to the Boardwalk and Beach Club hotels whenever you'd like. We also walk over to Fantasia Gardens Mini Golf. We had a direct view of the Swan from our room, and were able to see the fireworks from Fantasmic and Illuminations from our window. I enjoy the decor of the lobby and the rooms, which were comfortable and fairly roomy. We enjoyed a character meal at the Garden Grove restaurant, which served buffet. The food was pretty standard with typical Disney buffet fare, but the character dining experience, the character interactions were absolutely great, and it was the least crowded of the dining experiences I've been to, and we were able to spend more time with the characters than usual, and I saved the best for last. We were able to stay there for free using our Starwood Prefer guest points. Our next trip will be staying at the Contemporary, which I'm really excited about, and I look forward to future trips where we'll likely return to the Swan and Dolphin. So, clearly, I was wrong last week in speaking without really knowing too much about those hotels, because I have never stayed there, but clearly Ashley and Katie and Mike all recommend them as a good alternative to the Disney, actual Disney hotels that are on property around Walt Disney World. So maybe I'll have to give the Swan and Dolphin a shot sometime. Just a couple of more quick emails, and then we'll wrap up this week's show. Next email comes in from Lawrence, who writes, now that Cars Land is open, do you think they will have their own fireworks show like Disneyland sometime in the future, since Disneyland has both Fantasmic and a fireworks show? Lawrence, I don't think so. I mean, I'm just, you know, talking out of nothing. But in my opinion, I don't see California Adventure launching a fireworks show anytime soon. They did launch a handful of fireworks at the Cars Grand Opening, but that's far different from a full show. I think World of Color is certainly the big nighttime spectacular. It's a very long show, even longer than Fantasmic. And it keeps, you know, getting longer when they add to the beginning and the end and new sequences, et cetera, et cetera. That is certainly the nighttime event to be in that park. I don't see any reason for them to add a fireworks show anytime soon. Along that note, Alfred writes in and says, my family and I are enjoying your coverage of the grand reopening of California Adventure, Buena Vista Street, Cars Land, and now that DCA has been reimagineered, do you know if there are any plans to bring back the electrical parade? Alfred, I have not heard of any specific plans like that. The Pixar Play Parade did just return to the park. Of course, that's a daytime parade. And there have been rumblings that we'll get some kind of a new parade out here in Florida right around the time that new Fantasyland begins to open. But I'm not sure if that would be a daytime or a nighttime parade. I think it was supposed to replace, the daytime parade. That hasn't been officially announced or anything. As far as I know, as far as I've heard, the electrical parade is remaining out here in Orlando, which, much to the dismay of fans out in California, I am quite happy with. And I do have more emails and even a voice message to share, but we'll go ahead and hold it for there for next week and the week after at that point. Figured I'd just include a little bit of listener feedback here at the end of this very, very long show. So that's it for listener feedback this week. World's born at tomorrow. And that's where we're going to wrap up show 376, just shy of 2 hours long, and much, much more to talk about from Disney California Adventure still to come with the second half of Cars Land next week, along with most likely we'll be giving a review of Disney Pixar's Brave, which I'll be seeing tomorrow night. And then from there, in the coming weeks, we'll be talking more about Buena Vista Street, the grand reopening of a Disney California Adventure, and everything else that has come out of this recent trip to the West Coast, which I most thoroughly enjoyed. And then, of course, there'll be plenty more to share about things going on here in Orlando, and lots of excitement over this summer season. Really looking forward to it all. Hope you're enjoying it as well. Of course, you can check the website over at InsideTheMagic.net and our YouTube channel, especially to continue to follow all of the videos and articles and lots of photos. I took thousands of photos literally over the last few days, and I'll be uploading all of those in the coming days. So definitely keep checking back to the website to read all about even more than what I'm talking about here on the show as well. I do want to thank Magical Travel for sponsoring this week's episode of Inside the Magic. You can find out more about their services by visiting magicaltravel.com. And visit us over at lanyardlab.com to see all the different styles and custom lanyard options that we have available. You can request a price quote today to receive a free digital preview of your lanyard design. And, follow us on Twitter and Facebook and, of course, on YouTube. It's where I was live blogging from the last few days. I know lots and lots of people were really enjoying all the live pictures and updates throughout Disneyland. Of course, I'm back here in Orlando now, but I'll be heading out to the San Diego Comic-Con in just a few weeks, and I'll be sure to post a lot from there as well. So Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube are the best places to follow us on there, and just add /InsideTheMagic to any of those services to find us on there. So that's about it for this week. The show will return to a regular Sunday edition coming up on next week's show for 377. So thanks to all of you for listening and for watching each and every week. Have a magical week. Bye. Every day, there's a great big beautiful tomorrow. Just